gonna tell you about the coming of the judgment.
Fare thee well, fare thee well.
I'm gonna tell you about the coming of the judgment.
Fare thee well, fare thee well.
There's a better day a coming.
Fare thee well, fare thee well.
There's a better day a coming.
Fare thee well, fare thee well.
In that grave
a getting up morning. Fare thee well, fare thee well.
In that grave
a getting up morning. Fare thee well, fare thee well.
When you see the lightning a flashing,
fare thee well, fare thee well.
When you hear the thunder crashing,
fare thee well, fare thee well.
When you see the stars a falling,
fare thee well, fare thee well.
When you hear the chariots calling,
fare thee well, fare thee well.
In that grave
a getting up morning, fare thee well, fare thee well.
In that grave
a getting up morning, fare thee well, fare thee well.
When you see the lightning flashing, when you hear the thunder crashing, when you see the stars a-falling, when you hear the chariots calling,
good news, chariots are coming.
Good news, chariots are coming.
So glad,
so glad, chariots are coming. And I don't want to be left out.
There's a long wide road in the heavens, I know.
Long wide road in the heavens, I know. Long wide road in the heavens, I know.
I say good news,
good news, chariots are coming.
Good news,
good news, chariots are coming.
So glad,
so glad, chariots are coming. And I don't want to be left out.
In that
grave a getting up morning, fare thee well, fare thee well.
In that
grave a getting up morning, fare thee well, fare thee well.
In that
grave a getting up morning, fare thee well, fare thee well.
In that
grave a getting up morning, fare thee well, fare thee well.
Hello. I want to thank you for accepting our free gift CD entitled Praise God for Calvary. It's our desire for this music to be a blessing and an illustration of God's grace to us. Many years ago, when I was but a youth, someone came and shared God's love with me. They told me how mankind sinned in the garden, and that sin passed upon all, for God said all have sinned. He said because of my sin, God demanded of me a perfect sacrifice or eternal death in hell. Faced with this, he told me the greatest love story ever told. How he, the Creator God, the perfect, sinless Son of God, would come and live and die to pay my sin debt on Calvary, the just for the unjust. That if I would reach out and accept his payment for my debt, my life would change both now and forever. Friend, I don't know you, but just as someone came to me those many years ago and offered me the greatest gift of all, we thought by giving this free gift, someone might accept it. And here as I did, how God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. God's gift of eternal life is free, but it's not without cost. God loved you so much, he came and died on Calvary so you could live with him forever. Praise God for Calvary.
Yeah. tower, my safe place. You are the whip that can run dry. Give me life. You give me life. You're my oasis, stream in the wilderness. You are my tower, my safe place. You are the well, oh, that can't run dry.
You give me life.
You give me life.
You give me life.
You are
amazing. You're changing me.
How do you do? Anyone can have mood swings, from feeling buoyant and happy to down in the dumps. But if the mood swings are severe and prolonged, then something else is at work. The woman in this story experienced years of debilitating illness, but she went from tragedy to triumph when her heart and mind and life were unshackled.
Barbara, you're crying again? Can't you tell me what's wrong? Maybe I can help you. Please, if you won't talk to me, why don't you talk to the school psychiatrist? This isn't like you at all, Barbara. Please, get some help.
This is Unshackled, the longest-running radio drama in history. True life stories of real people, produced in Chicago by Pacific Garden Mission. Sleeping in the open and unable to bathe properly, the homeless have stopped caring what others think of them. Even so, going to a rescue mission is a big step for them because they fear losing their freedom. But doormen at Pacific Garden Mission welcome them, easing their fears. There they receive nourishing meals, fresh clothing, and a clean, safe bunk for the night. There they receive medical and dental care if needed, all without charge, thanks to friends who send financial gifts. Above all, they receive prayer and counseling about the way to change their lives. Those who take the step of faith, following that way, find their eyes are opened to the truth about themselves and the world, and that's when they find true freedom. That freedom is what this program is all about. Now for broadcast around the earth, here is program number 3017 in the series Unshackled, the program that makes you face yourself and think.
Barbara, what are you doing home?
I couldn't take it anymore, Mom.
You left college?
Yes.
But you were so close to graduating.
You think I don't know that? 9 credits to go, that's all. 9 credits.
Surely you could have stuck it out to the end of the semester.
No, I couldn't. All I did was cry, Mom. The stress was too much.
I prayed for you when you asked me to, but I guess it didn't help.
Nothing helps, Mom. Nothing. I'm just a loser.
The young woman in our story was far from being a loser. But it was years before she realized she had been duped by the enemy. This is the story of her emancipation, the true testimony of Barbara Caldwell, right now on Unshackled.
Not long after I was born in Newark, New Jersey, my parents separated and later divorced. I lived with Mom and grew up feeling distant, almost fearful of my father. Because Mom had to work, I stayed with a neighbor who was in our church. After 3rd grade, I became a latchkey kid, responsible for taking care of myself until Mom got home. As soon as I arrived from school, she expected me to call her at work.
Is everything all right, Barbara?
Yes, Mom.
Remember now, don't you be opening that door for anyone, you hear?
What if it's Cousin Marilyn?
Well, of course she can come in, but don't you go out. And you behave. And don't you be snacking too much. I'll make us a good supper when I get home.
Okay.
I have to get back to work, but you call me if you need to, if there's a problem.
Okay.
Keep the place clean now, you hear?
Then I thought Mom was strict, but now I'm glad she was. My aunt who worked with Mom lived right next door to us. We also had a church member who lived in the apartment upstairs, and I loved to visit her when I was older and allowed to leave on my own. So I had support all around me. Although I was mostly a loner, my favorite playmate was my cousin Marilyn.
Don't overdo it, girl.
Yeah, my chest is starting to hurt.
I don't want you to have a heart attack on me, Barb.
The doctor said I have a heart murmur, you know.
Yeah, I know. You ever feel scared of dying?
No. Everybody tells us that Jesus loves us so much that I shouldn't be afraid.
Yeah, you're right.
I just know he has something wonderful for my life. I was influenced spiritually by my mother, our neighbor, and the church we attended. I faithfully went to Sunday school. For many years, I learned scriptures without applying them to my life. And I loved the pastor of our church, who always encouraged us.
Read the Bible every day. God's word is the bread of life. And always pray before you read that God will give you understanding. Psalm 119, verse 18 says, "Open thou mine eyes, that I may behold wondrous things out of thy law." Yes, Lord, wondrous things.
I was always involved in a concert or play, and by the time I reached high school, I realized that I had a talent for singing and acting. the career path I decided to follow.
How was school, Barbara?
Great, Mom. I've been chosen to do an opera piece during the graduation ceremony. Imagine that, me singing a solo.
Well, I'm not surprised. You have a beautiful voice.
But so do other students in school.
But they weren't chosen for the city chorus, and you were last year. Now, that's a very select group. Only you and two other guys made it, remember?
Today, they announced it over the intercom, Mom. So all the other students heard my name. I'm so excited. First a big concert that was recorded, and now this.
You can go far if you want to, Barbara.
Oh, I do, Mom. I want to go far.
I didn't give the prom much thought at the end of my last year of high school, but the music teacher did. He set me up with a handsome guy who had already graduated. My cousin Marilyn made my white prom gown, and I felt like Cinderella. At the end of summer, a different music teacher drove me to the small private college she had attended in Virginia. A few weeks after I arrived, I landed a job as a dorm attendant. But everything didn't go as I had planned.
Grades are out.
I know.
Disappointed.
And then some. I'll do better next time.
You're awfully busy, Barbara. Traveling with the concert choir and all.
But it's only twice a year.
For 2 weeks? That's a lot of class to miss. Not counting the practice sessions ahead of time. Girl, that's a lot of time you're not hitting the books. And then, when you get back, you have to make up the work that you missed.
Well, I'm not giving up the concert choir. Singing is my life.
Your choice. I'm just saying, you can't have both. Good grades and a career?
Yes, I can. Next year, I'll do better. My grades improved after the first year, even though I stayed with the concert choir tour. It was in college that I finally got to know my dad better. Hello?
Barbara, it's Dad.
Hello, Dad.
Did you get the money I sent?
Yes, I did. Thank you. It helps a lot.
Your grade's pretty good?
I had a 3.5 last semester.
That's good.
I was even included in a who's who among students in American universities and colleges.
No fooling. I can brag about you then. You still singing in the choir?
Twice a year. I travel with them. We go out for 2 weeks each time.
When you have time to study?
Well, I squeeze it in. I'm a dorm attendant, too, you know.
My, my. You turned out pretty good. Your mama did a good job raising you.
Well, this year I plan to join a sorority.
Don't push yourself too hard, Barbara. Life has limits.
Yeah, but I'm tough, Dad. I'm determined to succeed.
I didn't realize the mind can only take so much. With the studies, work, travel with the choir, and then the sorority, I felt myself weakening. The last semester of senior year, when I did my student teaching, the pressure overwhelmed me, and I wrote my mother.
Please pray for me, Mom. I'm under a lot of pressure, and this is just the beginning. I'm getting a lot of headaches and tightness in my throat. I think it's the student teaching, but I plan to do my best. I have to get up at 6 o'clock every morning, get breakfast by 7, and start walking at 7:30 to be at work by 8, a half an hour before the children arrive. I'll be dead tired after teaching for 12 weeks. And then I have to work on campus all day Saturday and Sunday, so I hardly have any free time for myself. Everything is so hard, Mom. Don't forget to pray for me.
Dear Lord, help my little girl get through this stressful time. Remind her that she can always turn to you for your glory, Lord, for your glory.
Shortly after writing that letter to my mom, I would get up early in the morning and sit on the side of my bed, crying for no apparent reason. My roommate wanted to help, but she didn't know what to do. Finally, I had to make a decision.
Are you leaving, Barbara?
Yes.
So close to graduation?
Yes. I talked with the school psychiatrist yesterday, and he advised me to drop out and come back later. He said I appeared to be on the verge of a nervous breakdown.
I knew something was wrong when you started crying all the time. Are you going home?
Yes. Mom will be very disappointed.
I'm sorry.
So am I.
While I was in college, my mother had moved to Kenilworth, New Jersey, so that's where I went. She was very worried about me.
Are you still up, Barbara?
I couldn't sleep.
But it's 3 o'clock in the morning.
I'll sleep late tomorrow.
You've been staying up late night after night. Now, this isn't normal. And besides, it keeps me awake. I have to work tomorrow.
I'm sorry, Mom. I'll try to be quiet.
I want you to go to a doctor and find out what's wrong.
There's nothing wrong with me.
Oh, don't give me that. There is something wrong with you. Are you on drugs?
Of course not.
Then you're going to the hospital tomorrow, and don't give me any back talk.
At the hospital, they diagnosed me as manic depressive, gave me some meds, and kept me for a while. That was 1977, the beginning of years of confusion and spiritual darkness.
We'll hear more about that shortly. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. That's what Thanksgiving is all about. And we are grateful to God for providing this ministry to the homeless and for letting us reach the world through this program. Thank you, God, for our spacious new home with a larger medical and dental clinic that enables us to treat more patients more thoroughly. Thank you for everyone who supports this ministry in prayer through financial gifts and with volunteer efforts. Thank you for each radio station that broadcasts these testimonies and those who share their stories of your goodness and grace. Thank you for the translators who send these stories to faraway places in 8 languages. Thank you for every listener. We are grateful, Lord, for each homeless guest you bring us, each life transformed by your truth. The food we share each day would be nothing without the bread of life that comes from you, Lord. Truly, our God is the light burning in the old lighthouse. And we are grateful for every good and perfect gift he gives. Listening friend, you may join with us as we prepare to serve a bountiful meal to the homeless this Thanksgiving. Send your donations to 1458 South Canal Street, Chicago, Illinois, 60607. Designate your gift for Thanksgiving. Or donate online at unshackled.org. We praise God for your blessings to us.
Almost every year, my mother or someone else took me to the hospital because of my illness, and I became paranoid. During my manic phase, I roamed the streets at all hours of the day and night. Several times I ran away to New York, and more than once I left home abruptly with only the clothes I was wearing and barely enough money for food or shelter. Yes, it's me, Ma.
Where are you?
I don't know for sure.
You've been gone more than a week. Tell me where you are.
I'm not telling you.
Barbara, I'm worried sick about you.
I'm all right. And I'm not going back to that hospital.
Just come home.
And have you put me back in that place? Uh-huh. I'm too smart for that.
Are you safe? You could be in danger.
I'm not. I said I'm all right.
Do you have enough to eat?
Most of the time.
Where are you sleeping?
Too many questions.
Barbara? Barbara Ann?
Several times I caught a bus to another state, only to end up being hospitalized there because of my bizarre behavior. Once I went to New York and got lost in Jersey City. Confused and frightened, I stood at a bus stop trying to decide what to do.
Do you need help? You seem confused.
I am.
Where are you trying to go?
To my mother's place.
Where is that?
It used to be somewhere else. Now it's Kenilworth, I think. I'm not sure. I'm not sure anything anymore.
Maybe you should call and get directions.
I don't think I have any money left to make a phone call.
Then you can't ride the bus either.
I hadn't thought of that.
Why don't you come home with me? And we'll call your mother to come get you, okay?
Is my daughter Barbara here?
Yes. Come in.
How is she?
Very confused.
Well, she's not right in the head. She's ill, and she keeps leaving home.
You must be very worried about her.
I pray all the time.
Come on back. She's in the kitchen.
As if being bipolar wasn't bad enough, someone introduced me to transcendental meditation, and I began to meditate twice a day, thinking this would bring me peace. Instead, I wandered into the psychic world of parapsychology. From time to time, I worked, but my illness kept me from holding a job for very long. In the late 70s, I had my first professional singing job in a play in New York City. My cousin Marilyn was also in the cast. Are you staying for the cast party?
No. Are you?
Yeah.
Then I'm heading home. Will you be okay?
Of course. I know my way home.
Be careful.
Hello?
Hi, Barb. I was just making sure you got home all right last night.
It was an adventure.
What happened?
A young man came by who wasn't even invited to the cast party. Later, he invited three of us to his place just to hang out.
Uh-oh.
When we got to his apartment, I had one of those moments. Before he opened the door, I said, "Your apartment is full of plants."
And was it true?
Yeah. He was shocked that I knew.
Wow. You're clairvoyant, Barbara.
He had a photo album that I started flipping through after I asked his permission. And I recognized a face. I jumped up and I said, "I know this girl. She went to college with me. She died of cancer."
How did you know all that?
I don't really understand it. I hadn't seen her since college. Turned out, she was his sister, and he started crying. He made all of us leave.
I'm glad I wasn't there.
Ugh, I wish I hadn't been. No more parapsychology for me. It has taken over my mind. I was still going in and out of the hospital almost every year. There were a few years when I managed to live a more normal life. In 1982, I married, but after a month or so, I had an episode of manic behavior and my husband couldn't deal with it.
Barbara, where's your husband? Is everything okay?
Not exactly, Mom. My husband wants a divorce.
Well, what happened?
Guess I overreacted to something he said.
Oh, surely you can work this out.
I don't think so. He was pretty adamant.
But he knew about your illness before going into the marriage.
Yes, he knew about it. He just didn't know firsthand.
Well, you don't seem very upset.
I guess it wasn't meant to be. My husband divorced me, but I never cried about the failed marriage. My emotions were unpredictable. It was just another disappointment. I tried going back to college in Richmond, Virginia, but I had to withdraw because I needed surgery. I was staying with a woman off campus when I was hospitalized for another manic episode, but God used this woman to help me see my real need, a spiritual birth that would give me new life. Unfortunately, I had another episode and went home to be with Mom. Later, my parents drove me back to Richmond to get my belongings.
Well, Barbara, any plans?
I don't think I'll go back to college again. That was my second try and it failed. So I guess it wasn't meant to be.
Well, you sound certain.
I am.
What brought about that decision?
I surrendered my life to the Lord, and now I want to live for Him.
What brought that on?
I've been living in darkness, and it was taking over my mind.
But you made a profession of faith when you were little, about 8, if I recall.
Yes, I know, but that was just a profession, Ma. I haven't been living for the Lord. I planned my life and my career without considering God. And now I realize that I was made to bring glory to Him. The Spirit of God lives in me now. And as I read the Bible, the Lord will show me what I should do.
Well, I've always been proud of you, Barbara.
Even at low points in my life, like now?
Even then.
Thanks, Dad.
Nobody's perfect.
Except Jesus.
I always cried out to God when I was hospitalized.
Maybe God has other plans for your life.
I hope so. I can't change myself, that's for sure. But He can. I need the Lord, and I let Him know it.
You go to church with me on Sunday then?
Yes.
It was wonderful having my parents with me on that ride home, together, without bitterness. That was September 1992. I had been wandering in darkness for 15 years, ever since I had been diagnosed as manic depressive. And when I got home, I prayed fervently.
Dear Lord, please forgive my sin of disbelief, of following after other gods, especially the God of myself. Please forgive my sins that I've committed and wasn't even aware that I had committed them. God, take my life, Lord, and do whatever you want with it. I need you, Jesus, and I surrender myself wholly to you. Deliver me from the madness that has plagued my life.
On Sunday, I went to church with Mom, and the service was great. When the invitation was given, I went forward to confess that I had surrendered my life totally to Christ. Everyone rejoiced. Across the street from Mom lived a woman who held a Bible study in her home, so I attended every week.
This is an outline of each of the Old and New Testament books of the Bible, class. The Old Testament is just as important as the New, so study it and learn. Christ is concealed in the Old, revealed in the New.
What do you mean, Mrs. Adele?
I mean the Lord not only inspired the entire Bible through His Holy Spirit, but He also appears in many ways and many verses. From Genesis to Malachi, Christ is seen again and again, leading His people, preparing for His arrival. The prophet Isaiah especially talks about the first coming of Christ as a suffering servant, but He will come again in glory to take His people with Him. He came first as the Lamb of God, sacrificed for our sins, but He's going to return as a conquering king to establish His kingdom on earth. So read your Bible every day. It's your roadmap for life, teaching us how to find the right paths which lead to eternal peace and heaven. God will lead you by His word to accomplish His purposes.
I remember our old pastor saying that when I was little.
It's true. So be ready to meet Him.
I know that it begins with salvation. But how else are we to be ready, Mrs. Adele?
Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth.
That's why I'm here.
Stay close to God, because we don't know the hour or the day when He will come. Remember the parable of the 10 virgins? 5 of them were foolish and didn't keep oil in their lamps. When the Lord came, they rushed out trying to find oil, which is a symbol of God's Holy Spirit. But it was too late, and He said, "I know you not." So be ready.
I learned so much from that dedicated woman, and I haven't had an episode of manic depression since I was born again. In 2000, Mom and I moved to Albany, Georgia. And since that time, I began writing songs, expressions of my heart to God. In 2004, my dad agreed to drive me to see a Christian studio that would record my song. I sure do appreciate you doing this, Dad.
I like to travel, but the roads are icy, so I have to slow down.
Oh, there's no hurry, Dad. He that believeth shall not make haste.
You sure have learned the Bible.
The Lord saved my life.
How's your mother doing since the stroke?
About the same. She needs someone to help.
Someone staying with her while you're gone?
Yes.
I'm proud of you, Barbara. You sure have made a comeback.
The meds helped me to be stabilized, Dad, but the soul power of God made the difference in my life.
I'm glad.
The devil had me so confused for 15 years. And I've been healthy and well now for 15 years.
Isn't that something?
Mm-hmm.
Glory to God.
So many disappointments during those years of darkness. I missed a lot.
Well, the Lord sure is making it up to you.
Mm. I will restore to you the years that the locust hath eaten, God says.
He means what He says.
Amen. I always had faith that I'd be well one day, but I never dreamed that my life would turn out to be as exciting as it has. He has truly brought me from tragedy to triumph. The Lord removed all bitterness from my heart and replaced it with love. I thank God for the peace that floods my soul today. Last year, I wrote and recorded 2 singles. Nothing is impossible with God. Nothing. Trust, believe, and receive.
That kind of rescue and redemption is for you, listening friend. The Bible says, "For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved." Whatever has you bound, Jesus will set you free to live a life of purpose and joy. You can turn to him anytime, anywhere. There are no special words, because God looks on the heart. Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10 promise that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. If you need help in making that crucial decision, get in touch with Pacific Garden Mission, Chicago, Illinois, 60607. The telephone number in Chicago, 312-492-9410. Our email address is unshackled@pgm.org. Visit our website at unshackled.org to learn more about this ministry. This is program number 3017. Unshackled is produced by Pacific Garden Mission to show through true stories that if your life is empty, it can be filled to overflowing. We'd love to know you listen to and benefit from this program, so please write soon. The address, Pacific Garden Mission, Chicago, Illinois, 60607. Afraid of the future? Call Pacific Garden Mission in Chicago anytime and talk with someone who cares. 312-492-9410. Someone is waiting for your call. 312-492-9410.
Save me and give healing for my soul. And with the invitation, I knew it was the place where a sinner could come face to face with God's amazing grace.
I knelt at an old-fashioned altar and I stayed till I prayed through. I asked the Lord to change my heart and help me start anew. He promised he would walk with me.
Desperation, I was so ashamed to speak, but just like he had promised, my burdens rolled away, and I became a new creation. Praise his holy name.
something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus, like the fragrance after the rain. Jesus, Jesus, oh Jesus, let all heaven and earth proclaim. But there's something about that name.
Jesus, the mere mention of his name can calm the storm, heal the broken, raise the dead. At the name of Jesus, I've seen sin-hardened men melted, derelicts transformed, the lights of hope put into the eyes of a hopeless child. I've heard a mother softly breathe his name at the bedside of a child delirious from fever. And I've watched that little body grow quiet and the fevered brow cool. I've sat at the bedside of a dying saint, her body racked with pain, who in those final fleeting seconds summoned her last ounce of ebbing strength to whisper her sweetest name. Jesus. Jesus. Emperors have tried to destroy it. Philosophies have tried to stamp it out. Tyrants have tried to wash it from the face of the earth with the very blood of those who claimed it. Oh, yet it still stands. And there shall be that final day when every voice that has ever uttered a sound, every voice of Adam's race, shall raise in one mighty chorus to proclaim the name of Jesus. For in that day, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. So, you see, it was not mere chance that caused an angel one night long ago to say to a virgin maiden, his name shall be called Jesus. 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 Oh, there is something about that name.
Kings and kingdoms may all pass away, but there's something about that name. Yes, there's something